Thanks a lot. This next song is called The Backyard. This is great. Thanks for that.
Play anything, really. Just anything. mean, that's, you know, the whole question about what, about being a musician, what do I get out of it? I feel like, you know, that whole answer was just bullshit. And really, I mean, what I like is being liked, and I like, you know, having people watch me, and I enjoy performing, you know.
You know, there is definitely something about the music business that is so repelling that it's the one thing, of all the things that have ever happened, that's the one thing that makes me want to quit, because I, you know, and I don't want to quit, you know. I like everything about music except the music business. The business, not the music business. But. So, I mean, right now, right today, because of, I mean, we're in one of those situations that, band, you know, there's a lot of bands in a situation with their label where it's not, not a happy marriage. That right now, it's just probably the wrong time to answer, because, you know, make a speech when you're mad, and you'll make the greatest speech you ever regretted or something. So I don't want to do that, but I do hate the music business, and I can't stress it enough, but I'm in it. And so either there's, you know, it's sort of like either quit or shut up. So I'm going to shut up. But, you know, having said that, I, right now I don't see the end of the problem that we have now, which is, you know, basically we're on a label that just has shrunk to much less than they were, which is, you know, they didn't have far to go. So now we're sort of trapped and we can't really really proceed. We can't make a record and we can't make a record for somebody else. So, you know, I have optimism that we'll get on a different label, or something will change and we'll be on a different label and it'll be better. But I know that, like, there's a little voice in me that says it'll always be the same. It can only really change possibly through having success, where you're able to somehow bypass the actual business part of it and you know, do your own business and just go around them and then just give them the record and let them do their part of it, which is basically all a record company is. I mean, not all, but because I'm sure there's some nice people that work at them, is a place that sells music. So if you just give them they're no different than, you know, Stop and Shop or something, where they sell the product of music, you know, and I have the product. Unfortunately, they treat the creator of the product, you know, unless he proves he's successful, usually they treat him poorly, which never adds up. And that was too much whining, and I don't want to whine about it because everybody's got problems. You know?
I guess, yeah, probably. I come from that era. Yeah.
Okay. If you guys, like, had, like, an extra video, you would take some video that we could pay you. We were going to rent a camera today. But...
So I said goodbye, even though I know I'll die. I said goodbye to Mr. Miller. It's not important to me now. At least that's what I tell myself. I'm feeling now. I'm not in love enough.
Like 30 seconds.
Na, 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 na. You know, like.
a lot of people, there is no separation. You know, there's making a record, and that, and in the next breath, it's the promotional budget and the plan and the tour, and the all they do is live the total package all the time, 24 hours a day, and all their friends are in the music business, and all they talk about is the music business, and I've gotten horribly bored with all that, you know? I mean, that's fine. I mean, maybe that's what makes you successful. Maybe if you do it 24 hours a day, every day of the year, and everyone you know is in the music business, maybe you then become successful in the music business, but having a fulfilling life and a well-rounded life might leave something to be desired. I mean, I've made plenty of friends in music. I met my wife through being in a band, you know, so it's not like there's bad, they're all idiots. But I mean, it's very limiting to have, to just do that one thing, you know.
Hold on, I think I'm getting goofed up.
Great. I love it.
Wasn't really thinking about Morgan Creek.
I got the bat, I got for the choruses. Creek.
Perfect.
It's like that beat, whatever beat you, Eagles song, the early one where it's about a girl in the chorus, they go,
St. Louis, and I went up in the Big Arch. If you've been out to St. Louis, been up in the Big Arch. It's worth the trip. It really was worth the trip. Nothing matters what I say. You can sing along if you know the words. I'd rather burn this bouquet than give it away. Just to see if you could never lie. Should I know? Should I know? Should I know? I'm dragging you down to the Duncan Hotel.
My father probably doesn't really understand putting so much effort into something that is not the a normal career where money is involved.
I think my mom would like to come see me play sometime.
She's never seen you play.
She has here and there, you know, but not in a while.
Well, through high school and all, I was into the music that was around, which was, you know, Zeppelin and Yes. I was like a progressive rock fan. So I wanted to play the guitar, I thought. So I took lessons probably when I was a junior in high school or something. And it was just pathetic, you know. I couldn't do anything.
Just listening, taking Thursday off and getting up on the roof.
Gap between learning some chords and being Page is immense. You know, it's just like, it was so frustrating. It's like, I'm never going to be able to be in a band. And music at that point, when I went to see a band, it was at the Coliseum, and music was so distant from me. It was like, there were these guys that did the music way up there, who you never really saw. It was very mysterious, which was exciting in one way. But when you then pick up a guitar and think, I want to do this, there's too much of a gap. So eventually I gave up on the lessons and I put the guitar away. And I went to work in a record store in like, I guess, 77, right when I got out of school. And all of a sudden there was all these punk rock singles coming from Britain, and this was a really cool store, and we got all the singles, and we got the... And I bought the Pistols album, and I bought the Patti Smith's first or second album. And then I got into the Clash and all these bands, and I was the Buzzcocks, and I was like, this stuff is great, and it sounds like I could play it, you know? So me and the people that I knew at that time started playing some guitar. And then at the same time, we discovered that there was a punk rock scene in New Haven. There was a bar called Ron's Place. And you could go there and you could see bands, you know, as close as I am to you. It was amazing. There they were. And you could talk to them afterwards, and you could see them on the street. And, you know, you could do it. You could play Wednesday night, you know? And so all of a sudden it was like, wow, I'm going to do this, you know? But there was never any plan. And then through various things, I hooked up with Mark. We played in other things together, and Mark had been a drummer in bands. And then when all these various things had fallen apart, Mark and I, who had become friends, said, well, why don't we try to make some music? We'd never written the music in bands. We'd always been these sort of sidemen for other guys. And when they changed their mind or they wanted to do something else, you were left with nothing to do. So we thought, well, we'll write some songs, neither of us having really ever done it before. And it was like, well, Mark, you sing, because I certainly can't, and you've sung a little bit in bands that you've been in. So he decided he'd be the singer, and I was like, well, why don't you try to write the words? And I can't write any words. And so we wrote some songs and never thought anything of it. And then as it developed a little bit, we made a tape, which we made 100 of or something. And somehow it got some reviews around town, and somehow one got to Sounds in Britain, the newspaper, magazine, music newspaper. And they reviewed it, and they said it was good, you know? And by that time we'd come up with the name. We thought we had to have a name, so we came up with the name. And then all of a sudden it was like, wow, maybe we could be a band, you know? So that was when we got other guys to play in the band. And then then someone came up to us and said, well, I'll make a record with you guys. I'll put up half, you put up half. And we're like, well, geez, okay, we'll make a record. I don't know how to do that or what'll happen. So we made a record, Backyard album, our EP. And then we said, well, then we got 1,000 of those. I'm like, oh, geez, what are we going to do with these 1,000 records? And, you know, before we knew it, I mean, we sent a lot out. We sent hundreds of them out, and we did what we could. And before you knew it, we were reordering and reordering. The thing eventually has probably sold 20,000 records out of our basement. And, you know, that's how it all happened. It's very odd to look back on it. That's why every once in a while still I think, oh, I don't really do this, do I? So, you know, it's thanks to Patti Smith, and I guess, probably.
Thank you!
think it's hard to actually accept the fact that you are affecting, for me, it's hard to accept the fact that you're affecting someone. I mean, it's amazing, you know, and it is from a distance. I don't see it, happen. It's hard for me to imagine that there are thousands of our records in people's houses. But early on, we got I think after The Backyard came out, we got a letter from someone who had said that listening to our record had helped them get over the death of their father. And Mark and I are looking at the letter going, oh my God, what, you know. I think that was definitely the first time where it really struck me that people are listening to the music and it's having the same effect on them as music has had on me, you know, sitting in my room and you listen to this music and it's like, it's the ultimate, either positive or negative or whatever.
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It's,
you know. I'm the road manager. Taking it low tonight. I can't really sing that good tonight. I wish I could sing better, but I...
Take the Viter path.
I'm low in confidence. Some honey would have been a good idea.
I might have some in this place.
If I can jump as high as you.
Probably. Let me see if I can. Let me see if I can stand as tall as you are.
A hard time getting airborne. Let's see if you jump higher. Watch. Ready?
From a standing still or from...
Just right here. Any way you like.
Okay. Well, one, two, three.
Thank you.
After all these years, you know, all the different sort of configurations, I would say that the band that exists right now and has for the last 4 years or something is definitely the closest band. Not to belittle anyone that was in the band before, but maybe just we're a little older or something. Everyone knows how to carry themselves a little better. But I really think that it's the most relaxed time. No, but we've never had the problems that you hear about where, like, there's fist fights or, like, The Who or something. Someone breaks a chair over somebody's head. I mean, I would just walk out. That'd be it. In any situation, if someone broke a chair over my head, you know, I wouldn't come back. We've never had the problems that you hear about where, like, there's fist fights or, like, The Who or something. Someone breaks a chair over somebody's head. I mean, I would just walk out. That'd be it. In any situation, if someone broke a chair over my head, you know, I wouldn't come back. Or, like, the Kinks that Ray and Dave supposedly still have fitness fights. And they've been together for, like, you know, 30 years or something. It's absurd. So we've never had anything like that. Probably there's always strains. You're in a recording studio and, you know, big clock on the wall is ticking by and it's hundreds of dollars and you're screwing up your part and, you know, you take it out on one of the guys in your band, if you can.
The first chorus goes back to a verse again.
Good luck on this tape, Scott. I know you're going to get it.
Good luck to you.
Best drummer we have.
Good luck to you.
Where's the little
amp? Turn the high end all the way out. Treble.
I know what high end means, Drew.
Out of time, or it's just like a weird...
It's terrible.
Just do it again.
And if everybody thinks it's good, then no.
It's different.
How about the rest of the track?
Just that chorus, or do you feel more things?
Well, like, it doesn't start like the next beat. It goes into a different speed. It kind of immediately stays there.
Right. So what's the point then?
I don't know. Don't be pissed. I'm sorry that it's no good. There's no point in being pissed off about it, though. Well, why are you pissed?
I'm not pissed. It's just...
You see?
I can't understand why he waits till now to tell us that it was fucked up.
He wasn't singing on it before.
I wasn't singing to it. I mean, what's the problem? It just doesn't sound good. It's not like it's...
No problem at all.
But it seems like a problem. That's the worst part.
Well, I've just got to do it again.
Or if you're in the same band for 6 or 8 weeks in a row, things can get a little tense. But I think we're very close. You have to be. I don't understand these bands that don't speak with each other. You know, the ones that punch and the ones that don't speak, I don't understand that. I wouldn't be able to live that way.
No, our band is we're very close. Just really incredibly easy time of existing with each other. You know, on trips or whatever, there's never anything between us at all. Aside from all the crap that comes in from the outside doesn't ever seem to affect the core of the four of us. Only as people. You know? Not to say that, you know. I would say we could always play together in any circumstance, you know, down the road. We could always get together and play and help out and always be happy. I don't think we'll ever break up. I don't think we'll ever say, you know, we don't exist. It's really good. Scott and Dave, who are the last two to join. Ray and I have been together for a really long time. I don't know, just the way we got them and the whole way it came together was just really good, really lucky. You know, some bands like U2 or the Beatles and stuff have that. It can never be anybody else. That's how I feel about the four of us.
Star. Now I like doing music. I'd like to be able to do music and have access to the equipment and the time and other musicians that can allow me to do what I want. And it costs a lot to make a record. You know? It costs a lot to go into a studio. I mean, you don't have to do it that way. You can stay at home and do it on a four track. But I enjoy the process. Spending a lot of money on records. So things like that, I would like to, you know, I'd like to be able to keep coming up with things that I'm amazed I came up with, and then be able to share them with whoever wants to listen, you know. If the whole world doesn't want to listen, that's fine, you know. I mean, I think my whole outlook on the world has shrunk, and it's more important where I'm at and the people around me. That everyone is doing well, and that we're contributing our little good part to the world. And then, you know, if I sell a lot of records, that doesn't mean anything at all. So just, you know, I like making music. It's fun, and it's amazing that I can do it. I still every once in a while think like, nah, I'm just kidding everybody. I can't really do this. You know, I've conned everyone. They've given me, you know, record deals, and they don't realize that I don't know how to do this. So if I can just keep doing it. That'll be great, you know. But it doesn't have to be on any massive level. I don't need to fly between gigs. I don't know that there's ever been a bizarre fan experience. I'm amazed that, you know, let alone that we have, you know, that we have fans, you know. I mean, I didn't get into this in any kind of planned way. It was never like, I want to become a musician in a band and be successful.
Upstream seems so far away.
What do you want?
upstream seems so far away to me right now. But if we go into the woods, if we go into the woods, I swear that I'll keep you dry. And will you wear my coat? I feel calmer now than I ever did before. And it's just one night of peaceful sleep. That's all I ask. And it doesn't feel like a disguise when you wear my coat. And will you wear my coat? Song is for Josie Oss. A river that's flowing northerly, upstream seems so far away. If we go into the woods, I swear that I'll keep you dry. And will you wear my coat? Will you wear my coat of butterflies? Will you wear my coat? Wear my coat of butterflies, butterflies.
I don't like it. I don't like that a lot of the people that are involved in it, they don't really love music. I mean, I think some of them think they do, but they love money more than they love music. And you know, I like money too. Everybody likes money, but it's like I don't. You know, you see how they sometimes some people are really obvious. You see how they're looking at you. You know, they're looking at you as a chance to make money or to further themselves. And you know, I don't know. I don't think that way personally. You know, so I. It's a hard place to like exist. And so, the object for us, for me anyway, is to. The only way you can really call your own shots or whatever is to be successful. So, if somehow, you know, because we're not like really successful, I mean, you know, we're not a business success. We can't say, you know, we're going to do this, we're going to do that, this is how it goes, you know, don't bother us. So we're stuck to the business, and unfortunately for us now, we're stuck in one of the situations, you know, that happens to bands is, you know, we're not getting along well with our label, and we want to get off the label, and they, you know, won't let us go. It's one of these, you know, kind of things that you hear about. We're under contract kind of thing. And, you know, because of that, right now is probably not the right time to say what do I think, because I don't feel like it's a good, you know, whatever. It's not the right time for me to speak about it. What we want to do is get successful. If we ever get off this label and ever get onto another label, and if it's good, which I mean, I still have optimism that it would be good. We want to try to get around the music business and make a record and turn it in, and then go on with our business and not have to be trapped by, you know, what their ideas of what to do are, or, you know, whatever. I'm not making sense, I don't think, but anyway, I don't know, my head is muddled about trying to talk about that for some reason.
Yeah, pre-gig jitters definitely exist. I think if you weren't nervous at all, it would probably be a pretty tame show. I think, you know, there must be something to be said for the tension adding to things. But I guess I'm pretty good at it. I'm much better at walking on a stage and playing music than going up to a stranger and saying hello. I'm terrible at that. I wish I was better at that. I'm about to go on this long cross-country trip, and I'm really trying to get myself to be able to talk to strangers, because I know that's one of the things I'm missing out on in life. And I can't do it, but I can go on stage and play in front of people. The more, the better, actually. The interesting thing is, the bigger the crowd, the less you don't see anybody then. If there's one person, it can be really nerve-wracking. But if there's 1,000, you don't see any of them. Especially, I think it's really good if the lights are really bright. But yeah, I mean, you're a little nervous. Usually it takes a couple songs, and then especially if things are going well and the audience seems responsive, it just gets better and better, you know. Then if you have a really good audience and you're doing really well, then you can get those really magical nights where it's just like, it's out of control. You don't have any hand. It feels like you don't have any hand in it, and it's just, you're just along for the ride.
Since we did the last record and went on tour, the first part of the last tour we did was really hard. I mean, the last year we did a long tour called the We Are All Lost Tour. And the first part of it was just agony, you know, because we had a different expectation of where we were. You know, we just signed to a bigger label than, I mean, it's a bigger label than Rough Trade, which is what the label we used to be on. And we thought that we were going to be a lot more well known, and it was going to be different than it had been. And it was not only not different, but it was almost a little worse in some ways, for whatever reasons, you know, all reasons, I suppose. So we went through that part of the tour, and so going on stage in those days was like, it was almost, I hate to say this, but for anyone that was at the shows, but it was just like, you know, here we go again, you know, this sucks. Everybody was just really kind of disappointed, because we didn't feel like we should have gone on tour in some ways, and it just whatever, had a lot of problems. So then we went to England and did some shows, and that was good, because, you know, we're rare over there, and you go to England and, you know, play in London, and it's good, you know. And then we came back home and did nothing for a little while, and then we sort of decided to organize a tour again, so, you know, part two, which was more into the fall, on our own terms, which was not to involve the record company and not to involve anything of any kind of like corporate nature. It was just strictly what they call grassroots. And so we went out and did that and had a fantastic time, because we had a much different expectation. So the feeling of going on stage then was, you know, was just a good, healthy, happy, you know, I don't want to use like excitement, but just a good feeling going on and knowing that, you know, why you were there, and that you were there for a good, you know, for your own self, not to promote or particularly or anything.
Bring down, boys.
Hello.
What are you doing with the ball stuck, Scott?
Maybe we'll pay.
This is a real problem.
It's a good idea listing it.
It's just started to rain, but I'm already drenched.
It's a big black night down in a Benson hearse.
Since we did the last record and went on tour, the first part of the last tour we did was really hard. The last year we did a long tour called the We Are All Lost Tour, and the first part of it was just agony, you know, because we had a different expectation of where we were. You know, we just signed to a bigger label than Rough Trade, which is what a label we used to be on. And we thought that we were going to be a lot more well known, and it was going to be different than it had been. And it was not only not different, but it was almost a little worse in some ways, for whatever reasons, you know, all reasons, I suppose. So we went through that part of the tour, and so going on stage in those days was like, it was almost, I hate to say this, but for anyone that was at the shows, but it was just like, you know, here we go again, you know, this sucks. Everybody was just really kind of disappointed, because we didn't feel like we should have gone on tour in some ways, and it just whatever, had a lot of problems. So then we went to England and did some shows, and that was good, because, you know, we're rare over there, and you go to England and, you know, play in London, and it's good, you know. And then we came back home and did nothing for a little while, and then we sort of decided to organize a tour again, part two, which was more into the fall, on our own terms, which was not to involve the record company and not to involve anything of any kind of like corporate nature. It was just strictly what they call grassroots. And so we went out and did that and had a fantastic time because we had a much different expectation. So the feeling of going on stage then was, you know, was just a good, healthy, happy, you know, I don't want to use like excitement, but just a good feeling going on and knowing that, you know, why you were there and that you were there for a good, you know, for your own self, not to promote or to. Okay, so then we came home and then we had a big change about going on stage, which was when I know there's some footage in this thing of us playing in Newport, Rhode Island, which is where we, you know, ostensibly went to write the record that we haven't been able to make yet. And we started playing this Monday night gig, which was under a fake name, and you know, no one knew who we were, and so it was a whole different thing. It wasn't like being on tour. It was nothing to do with anything we had ever done, and it was just going down to this bar and playing on the house equipment, and then, you know, basically being kicked off after half an hour because, you know, that was our time limit. You know.
Just want to ask one thing: is Billy Rose here tonight, by any chance? When you see him tomorrow over at Mel's Lunch, tell him we were thinking about him. See how he comes here. I'm in my reading glasses on. Nearly. I have 20/10 vision, by the way.
How'd you get that?
Changes, and even if it's Boy George or something, you know, that just doesn't, you know, or no, something, even if it's the Bay City Rollers, you know, they counted when they were around, you know. And then I just, if you didn't know anything about music and you didn't ever pay attention to rock music or something, and even if you hate it, I mean, it is important to people, and whether it's important to you or not, you know, it just means something now. I know that it doesn't mean anything in 20 years, but whatever, you know, give it some respect.
Ah!
Thank you.
talking about what the Lord will bring back to me. It's like a tick tock, actually, to remember. Like, you should know when you're certain.
I'm going to start the days and for a report.